What did he do?
So how are you?
I'm good.
You seem relaxed.
Do I?
You do.
Jeans, because I'm wearing jeans. I'm very much got into sneakers recently.
That's good though.
I would call them trainers, but if I say trainers, you know what I
mean. Do you wear expensive sneakers or do you just wear normal
shoes? Reeboks, no, $100. I'd call that pretty expensive.
So you're not going to Supreme and getting the $400 silly sneakers?
No, without a hefty discount.
Well, I'm sure there's a celebrity discount somewhere. I'm not sure there is one there.
If I am now seen wearing those really fancy ones, you're going to judge me.
People will talk about you.
Yeah.
Well, it's amazing how much people send out sneakers on this town.
It's not just this town. I think sneakers have suddenly become really important and fancy.
Yeah, it's weird.
I can't. They're trainers. But I'm not going to say that now, because maybe my husband will buy me some, and then you'll see it, and then, you never know.
So are you mellow?
Am I mellow?
Yeah. Are you mellowing?
Oh, I'm mellowing. Well, no, I'm hustling. I'm doing press for wildlife, but I'm not gearing up for a next thing.
But it's interesting. As I was looking at your career, it's not even a decade since all Saul started around.
No, not really. No, I mean, well, since
9 years since education.
Yeah. Oh.
It's only 9 years.
I know, but that just suddenly seems like a very long time.
It feels like it because you've been through a lot.
Yeah. I haven't worked that much, though.
Well, you've made about a movie a year or something like that?
Yeah, roughly. Yeah.
Roughly. Mm. But it actually occurred to me that you don't, unlike other actresses of your status, you seem to be aging into your role seems to be coming with you.
Mm.
And it seems to fit as you kind of mature yourself and as you've gotten older, your role seemed to kind of fit in a way that usually people are pushing it in a direction or doing something very wild or somehow going out of themselves.
Mm.
It seems to me like you are kind of just going at a nice, even pace.
Age appropriate.
Somehow.
That sounds so boring.
Or life appropriate. Oh, I
mean, age appropriate choices.
Well, she couldn't. I don't think you could play this role in wildlife.
No, for sure not. No, I think that's right. I mean, like, for a long time, I was kind of annoyed to be offered 16-year-olds, you know, when I was 25.
Right.
Now I'm definitely not getting offered 16-year-olds, but it's, you know, I think it is a strange thing to be comfortably playing the mother of a 14-year-old. You know, I even remember when Paul sent me the script. I did have a slight doubt in my mind as to whether I was too young. And they were like, no, you're not too young. You're the perfect age. Which is devastating.
Do you have to think hard about that? I mean,
I didn't have to think at all. I mean, I read it,
right.
But then I called him immediately back.
But did you have to think about the age, playing the mother of a 16-year-old?
Is that a thing,
or is that just another person in the house?
I mean, I suppose, you know, I have two small children, so I suppose you're always trying to, you know, you're putting yourself into the shoes of somebody else. So so you do have to consider how am I going to find my way into, you know, that amount of life experience that I haven't had? How do I kind of give myself 14 years worth of motherhood and make that feel natural and not like, sort of false? But no, not in any other kind of sense.
So when you get the script, it's, you know Paul,
yeah.
And you know Zoe.
Yeah.
So is it, obviously you jumped in with both feet.
Yeah.
Is it a lot of conversation that you may not have with other writers and directors about the material, or?
Kind of. I mean, not really. I mean, the character was so on the page. That was what was so striking. Was, you know, I've had such amazing opportunities, and I've worked on brilliant things. I've had some experiences where I've come to a script and the director's been amazing and I thought, well, you know, the character's almost there, but, like, you know, I bet you we can work together and make her even better or make her or find that other thing. But with Jeanette, it was written, you know, and we barely changed a word, I think, you know, in shooting. So that having this, like, fully formed, incredibly complicated, exciting part just on the page was amazing.
So you knew who she was?
There were things that I immediately understood about her, but I didn't know how to do it. But there were things that I was like, oh, I see what's happening to her, and so those were some of the first things that we talked about was, and I've used this sort of made up term a lot, but it sort of looks to me like nostalgic whiplash, like, you know, that feeling of, you know, you hear a song and it makes you think about a time, and, you know, and sometimes that's like, oh, I remember when we listened, and sometimes that makes you kind of, scares you, you know, it's a jolt, it's like, frightens you that amount of time has passed, or that whole experience is over, or, you know, and I think that's what that was one of the first things that I saw in her, is like, gosh, she's terrified of the fact that she's not 20 anymore, and that she can't have those things that she had, which was just opportunity. She can't have, like, you know, the world is not her oyster anymore. And not that it massively was for, you know, woman 40s, but, you know, it certainly isn't now. And so how is she going to react to that? And I think her reaction to that is kind of, you know, part of what we're seeing in the film.
Well, maybe the hardest thing to figure out in the movie is what this couple was like 10 years earlier.
Yeah.
When they had a teenage boy, and I was like, there must have been some, you know, must have been happy. You kind of see them being happy for a year or two.
Yeah.
But the idea that they were happy for 15 years.
I mean, I think they were, but I think she's had her, I think whatever they had, certainly, I think in both of them, but speaking just for Jeanette, I think she's just had her personality kind of suppressed for so long. And she's fully embraced motherhood and wifehood, and she's, you know, she's got this incredibly impressive veneer of, like, look at, you know, and there's even a line in the book that I think Paul really loved, and, you know, where Joe is talking about his mother and says, like, people would look at her and think, gosh, she's a real smart lady, she's pretty, she's got her act together, like, doesn't she look like she has a wonderful life? And I think Jeanette's worked so hard at convincing people that that's the case for so long, that when, you know, when it starts to break apart, she doesn't actually know who she is, because she's just been literally wearing an apron and playing that role, and it feels like a role, and when that falls away, she can't actually say who's underneath it.
And yet she seems incredibly strong in this
moment. Yeah, I think strong in the way that, like, you know, yeah, I think she is, and I think she's, and there is also a survival instinct that's kicking in. You know, how do I get through this? He might be gone for good. He might die. He might have left me for another woman. Like, she's catastrophizing, but it's not out of the realm of possibility that he's never coming back. And then she has nothing to go back to. She has no education. She doesn't have any skill set. So now she's got a 14-year-old, and she's on her own, and it's 1960. So, you know, there is a survival element. Like, I must attach myself to someone who can sustain this, someone who can, you know, provide and make us safe.
She actually seems like they'd almost be better off without her ever coming back. I mean, there's an element of that.
I think part of what she's doing with her son in that week is, like, just eviscerating any idea of who she was before. So, you know, how do I erase former Jeanette and become someone that I can stand behind? Like, she feels so little of herself. She has such low self-esteem. She doesn't believe in, you know, who she is. And I think, you know, part of everything she's putting Joe through is, like, forget that. That's not me. None of that was me. That was me putting on a thing. Now, I'm going to introduce you to who I really am. But the problem with that is that she doesn't know. So, you know, it's a misguided logic. But I think what she's doing is, like, taking him on the journey of her own self-discovery and putting him through the paces, isn't it?
It's funny because it's almost like Zoe and Paul just had a kid, but they don't have a teenager.
Mm.
And so, like, the idea of, there's something about how one lives with a kid is the kid becomes the person.
Mm.
And you have to start to realize that they're seeing you one way.
Yeah, right.
You don't live that until you actually live it.
No, and you have all, you know, you have all those conversations. I've got two kids, and I'm always having conversations with my friends, like, well, what are we going to tell them? You know, are we going to be honest? And, you know, you know, my daughter will notice a tattoo on me, and, you know, she's three, so I'll say, like, oh, it's just a sticker, you know, but one day she'll know that it's not, and will I tell her, why did I get it, and, what, you know, should she get one, and, like, will I tell her about the mistakes I made, and try and prevent, or will I just pretend that I didn't make them, and model good behavior, you know, all of those things that you don't have to confront until your kids are older, but then the reverse of that, of, like, you know, seeing your dad cry for the first time, and thinking, like, oh, he's not Superman, and it's terrifying, you know, because you just, so, and that's what the film deals with, is just, like, that curtain falling down and everyone seeing each other as people as opposed to the roles that they're playing.
So what's a set like that like?
It's pretty fun.
Was it?
Yeah, it's pretty fun. Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously there's, like, you know, big fights and dramatic scenes, but those are the most fun things to shoot, so we're all pumped and, like, excited to be doing it. And Jake and I had wanted to work together forever and never found the right thing, and and this was kind of amazing, you know, to do. So, and there were like difficult bits, obviously, and there were bits that needed a lot of working out, but yeah, it was fun. I mean, you know, the scene where Joe comes home and finds me in the living room with Warren Miller with Bill Camp, like, we did a couple of minutes of improvisation before Joe came in. It was so much fun. It was like the first thing I shot with Bill, but Bill's the most hilarious, brilliant actor. And, you know, so there was, peppered in there was like lots of really fun things.
And is Paul set relaxed and easy?
Yeah, I'm thinking about Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Paul's set is exactly how you imagine, you know, Paul's set to be, like, completely calm. And I think what was distinct about it was, like, everyone was there because they believed in Paul and they loved Paul. And they wanted him, you know, to be able to fulfill his vision, and they believed that he could. And I think that's largely to do with, you know, the ridiculous amount of integrity that he has as an actor and how truthful he is, because you can't imagine an actor that's that truthful and has that much integrity making a bad film. It just seems, I mean, it's totally possible, and, you know, but he's so smart, and people loved him, so he created a completely wonderful set where everyone was psyched to be there, and like, yeah, so it was great. So that's the perfect environment to like.
It's funny, I think that the two of them are so lovely, and it almost, I feel like, it's an imposition. Paul and Zoe.
Yeah.
Like, that, you know, they're so nice that you kind of like, now it becomes like a something that's forced on them.
Yeah, right,
but
right.
They can't
right.
be anything but incredibly nice and thoughtful.
Yeah, I mean, they, you know, they are, there's, you know, truly special people, but they're just so, you know, the kind of creative outlet that they and the output that they have is insane. Like, I don't know anyone like them. You know, Zoe and I have been such good friends for such a long time, and when she's not acting, she's writing, you know. When I'm not acting, I'm trying to go to sleep, you know, or watch reality television. But she's, you know, she's always putting stuff out there and, like, creating and thinking. And so they are a formidable couple, but... but, you know, I think the combined effort, the way that they wrote this script together, even just the time that they took to do it, really, really translates to the film. Because I think the script is so strong, and, you know, and I think that's a product of 4 years of really thinking about it, you know.
Well, there's something so relaxed about it. I mean, it's very specific visuals and very specific shots, and yet it feels easy in a way.
Yeah.
It's an interesting combination.
I think, and that's always how, you know, I think that's a lot of the way that it's shot is, you know, the frame is held and the camera only moves if it needs to move. And so within that, you have so much freedom as an actor. So, like, you know, if it's a wide shot, you can move within that space. You don't have to worry about anywhere you're going, about being, you're just lit and you can move. And I think those are the parts of the film that felt like theatre where we could just be in the frame. And the scene where Jake leaves for the wildfire, that final wide shot where we're having a huge, you know, row in front of Joe. I think we shot that like 16 takes in a row. And we would just keep resetting ourselves and then go again, you know, reset. And there was like one version where the whole table was covered in paper and I just swept it all off onto the, you know, it was like we were living out all of our fantasies of the biggest row you've ever had in your life. But, you know, that stuff is so much fun to do. And because, you know, Paul was so smart because, you know, you watch the film and it's so beautiful. And I think Diego did an incredible job as well. But you're not, as an actor on set, thinking, oh, I'm in a film where the director is obsessed with how it looks. Like, or even, you know, he knew exactly how to shoot it. And but within that, you know, there's a freedom, you know, because he's figured it all out already. It's like working with the Coen brothers, where they know already what it's going to be. And, you know, they've decided everything. And then... but, you know, so we shot that thing 16 times in a row. Not once did anyone come in and, like, mess with my hair or, like, check my eyebrows or, like, wipe the sweat off Jake. It was just about the performance. And, you know, Paul knew that the sort of visuals were taken care of.
I kind of feel like the comments is always going to happen, like, 5 years from now.
I know. We should ask them.
They've got some sort of idea of the universe that none of us help. None of the rest of us have. She's been letting people in out of secret lately. Francis.
Oh, right, yeah.
Oh, really?
She became very, all of a sudden she became a public figure. It was like a little scary for me. Like,
yeah.
The whole gig is going to be given up.
Yeah, I know.
But they're back in hiding again. That's good.
Yeah, that's good.
Hanging out with Wachowski somewhere. Probably. So at a picture like this, do you look at dailies? Do you look at footage? Do you look at anything?
I don't look at anything on any movie. I've watched the movie, yeah. I've seen it actually 3 times, which is more than I've seen any movie I've done in the last decade, I think, apart from maybe an Education, Gatsby.
Were you looking for something, or were you just...
No, we just, it screened, they showed it to me in New York when I was there last year for Mudbound doing press, and then I saw it with my mum and my best friend, and then I saw it, we sat through at Sundance, because that was the first kind of public screening of the film, and then we were, Paul was honoured at Cannes in the Critics Week, so we sat through and watched the film there.
And you enjoy listening to an audience, or do you even know they're there at that point?
I don't enjoy listening to an audience.
I mean, do you like having that experience of them experiencing you?
It's not really, I mean, it's because it's not a kind of, I suppose it's not really that kind of film where they're, you know.
There's not a lot of laughing.
Audibly responding, exactly. Yeah. We did have a great laugh. We did a Q&A in Toronto, and we came back to do the, we didn't watch the film, but we came back to do the Q&A right towards the end of the film, and it was, I mean, we came back a bit early, but we overheard the line where she's driving, and she says they're on the border of Canada, and she's like, oh, I can't deal with Canada tonight. It's like the only laugh we got. they loved it.
Canadians love jokes about Canadians.
Yeah. But no, so it's not so much that, but I just think, like, as a, you know, as a film, I think it's so beautiful, and I get chills watching Bill Camp act. I just think he's incredible. So I, Zoe and I sit there holding hands, you know, it's like we've made a, you know, we're like best friends, we've made a film together. It's kind of magical, and you know, that's kind of what you dream about, isn't it?
It's the Bill Camp thing is so odd, because it's almost like he was away somewhere for 20 years, and all of a sudden everybody figured it out at the same time.
But isn't that the way with, like, great character actors? You're probably the same of Olivia Colman. Like, yeah. You know, most people have known that she is exceptional for many, many years, but now, you know, the entire universe knows it.
Yeah.
It's just one of those things.
But she's never stopped. I mean, she's always famous in England.
She was always famous in England, but, like, you know, now it's, I think there's...
She's about to have a big moment.
Well, yeah, there's just an ultra appreciation for her always incredible talent, but, you know, now it's sort of... It's the same thing with Bill.
So have you seen Favourite yet?
No. I can't wait.
It's fun.
Yeah.
It's just like enormously...
Yeah.
I keep on comparing it to whatever happened to Baby Jane.
I haven't seen that film.
Oh, it's the old... It's the movie with Joan Crawford and Betty Davis.
Their
sisters, one throws the other one down the stairs and all that kind of...
Yes.
It's like a high camp...
Yeah.
But also Yorgos is insane brilliance.
Yeah.
And the women who are all amazing.
Amazing, isn't it? Yeah.
The three, though.
Always, yeah.
But it's like a three-person scenery chewing...
Yeah.
Joy.
Yeah.
To watch this movie.
Yes. I mean, can't wait.
But you haven't really had much of a chance to do.
What, that kind of thing?
Yeah. Would you like to go? I mean, I guess in the Coen Brothers movie, actually, was the...
I've yelled at a few people. Yeah. I mean,
you got your fucks out.
I've gone for the best gig I could get for years, you know. So I'm kind of always trying to find something I haven't done before. So I think it's, you know, we'll see what comes up, but... And in retrospect, looking back, there are so many period films, but there's never been a kind of... I've never done anything massively by design. It's always been pretty much on gut instinct. Like, you know, I've known whether I'm going to do something within an hour of reading it, you know. Bar maybe the monologue I did this year, which was on stage, which I had to think about a lot because it was, you know, terrifying. but, you know, other than that, everything's been like, yes, no. You know, those have been the things I've done.
So do you feel empowered to make a lot of choices? Do you turn down a lot of things?
I haven't done anything or? I didn't feel... No, I mean, I'm not like, you know, they're not banging the door down, but I haven't done anything that I haven't been... I've had a rule since an Education that unless I can't bear the idea of anyone else touching it, then I do it. But if I can imagine another actress doing it, then I'm gonna...
And do you have anything any conceptual idea of something you want to do? If you're looking for a musical or another chance to sing, another chance to dance? Max von Sydow went and asked him, you know, what he hadn't done in his career at 85 years old.
Yeah.
And he said, I want to do more comedy.
I mean, yeah, I don't know. I mean, you know, I part of doing this play was... that the first half of it was comedic, that it was funny, that you were required to make an audience laugh and make them laugh on your own, which is terrifying. But I loved it, so I totally would want to do comedy. I totally want to do something set in space. Like, I don't know what it is. I know what it isn't, and that's kind of like old ground. But I don't know I can't say like dream role is this, because it kind of probably hasn't been written yet.
Was the series experience different for you? Was it interesting? Or?
Yeah, it was very interesting. I mean, it was fun to, you know, I really wanted to work with SJ, I thought she was a great director, and I, you know, I'd worked with David on Skylight, so, you know, it was great. And it was great to work. You know, what I loved about that job is that, you know, David sent it to me and I read it and I thought it was brilliant, and I wrote back to him and said, I'm like 8 weeks pregnant, and, you know, you're like the third person I've told, but it, this is great, but does that preclude me from doing it? And he said, I have no reason to suspect that it would, you know, why can't she be pregnant? And so we sat down and he said, well, we're never going to talk about it and you're not going to cry. And I was like, I'm in. Let's do it. And I love that. You know, I think, you know, women are extraordinary, and they carry babies to full term and work the entire way through it, and they don't walk around clutching their backs and whinging about it for the most part. And we just have such funny ideas of what women are like on screen. And it's sort of patronising in a way. And so what I loved about Kip was that she's full term pregnant, walking around arresting people and not talking about it. And I think, you know, that's a more accurate representation of women, pregnant women working, you know, working today than we are usually used to seeing.
And you were actually doing it.
And I actually was doing it.
I was
properly pregnant. By the end, I was like 7 months pregnant.
Was it hard to, I mean, ultimately, I don't want you to whinge now, but was that...
No, it wasn't.
Does it make it more difficult, or is it?
No, I mean, I was, you know, I was very, on the scale of, you know, I was incredibly lucky. I had very easy pregnancy and not, you know, so it was, for me, it was fine. It was kind of great. Fun to be working, you know, fun to be able to work as an actress during that time when usually you kind of can't.
Well, you seem to have found a way to make it all work. I can't imagine you being in any way neglectful of your children at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, in a way, things haven't massively, I think the criteria for work has been, for change for me, just because of the kind of luck that I've had with the roles that I've played. So, you know, getting to do Girls and Boys and getting to do Wildlife, those are two characters now that need to be topped, you know, and so I feel like I've been so lucky with these parts that, so, you know, having kids, I'm so lucky to be able to choose, you know, when I work. It's just an extraordinary privilege. So I don't take it lightly. So I kind of hold out for the things that will match the quality of writing in Wildlife and then Girls and Boys.
So what happens when that doesn't happen?
Right now.
So you're just hanging out and waiting for the magic
to happen? Yeah, I mean, kind of, yeah, that's it. Just waiting. But it's been a waiting game for the last 9 years. Yeah. And that's great.
And do you feel, as an actor, do you feel different 9 years later? Do you feel, I mean, obviously, I'm sure you feel more experienced and more relaxed about certain things and all of that, but do you feel that it's changed for you as a thing you wanted to do when you were a kid?
No, not really. I mean, I think just the bar keeps getting set higher in terms of the opportunities. You know, I feel like I'm sort of holding out for the right stuff, and that probably used to really concern me, and now it doesn't, because I've probably got other things in my life to be doing. So I suppose in that sense I'm more relaxed about things, you know, relaxed about the waiting periods, because it's not really waiting. I just carry on with the other part of my life.
And you go to weddings, because God knows nobody noticed you were at a wedding.
No.
Is that the strangest thing in the world, to just go participate in something and have it become a... somehow you're part of the cultural event of the...
I mean, yeah. It's just, you know, in some ways, yes, but in some ways, like, it's just a friend's wedding. Like, I'm not, right. You know, not to be blasé about it, because I recognise it as a historical, amazing event, but I also see it as, like, our friends got married, so that's nice. So, yeah, yes and no. But it is, you know, it's obviously bizarre to be in something that's televised.
Well, I think I was looking on the line or saw something, and it was something about your husband yawning or something. And I was like, and I saw the 23 sites, so you know, it's everywhere in the world. And I'm like, wow, how very important that was.
It's very important.
We all talk about it endlessly.
It's very important.
Very, very important.
We should talk about it more.
And do you feel like you've found it? You live in New York, yes?
No, I live in London.
Oh, you live in London?
Yeah.
So is that your cultural base?
Yeah, basically, yeah.
And do you have a circle of people around you? Is that like a place where it's
a what, like
of human beings, of
a family? Oh, actors. I don't have like that many. I mean, London's mainly like school friends and people I went to. I mean, I've got, you know, but I don't have a massive amount of like close actor friends. So it's not kind of in that sense, but it's a hub. It's my family, friend, and right. Where I'm always going to live.
Real life.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's interesting because some actors seem to have like kind of these groups developed in different places.
Yeah. No. I mean, like I would say that Paul and Zoe and I and Jake have that. Like, you know, we've always lived in totally different places, but like, you know, we've always kept an eye on each other and always been friends and always wanted to figure out a way of doing something together. So I certainly have that with other actors, like people that I've worked with or people that I have met, and you know, but I don't like my group of friends at home is not that.
Are your show business friends? And these aren't your show business friends either.
No, they're not. Yeah.
Of course, Jake can't stop anywhere for more than 3 minutes. That's his.
No. What do you mean?
He's always on the run. He always seems to be going to the next set, the next thing.
Oh, he's,
he works so much.
He does, yeah. I mean, it's relentless. It's all amazing.
It's fascinating. It's amazing that he, you know, yes.
Yeah.
He's been in this course more than a few times.
They're all like, you know, how can you turn down some of those, you know, those roles? Yeah. That's the thing. If I was offered an endless stream of incredibly interesting, three-dimensional, satisfying roles, I'd probably work a bit more too.
But see, Jake goes to wacky places that you have not been going to. You've not been asked to go to, I guess.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, there's nothing stopping me if I was offered the right thing.
So you going somewhere where you're like...
I've done a one-woman show. I've been on stage for 90 minutes on my own, acting out with invisible children. I would 100% go to the wacky places. It's all about the opportunities that are offered to you. You know, I feel like relatively fearless in that respect. But now having done that, there are few things that I wouldn't have a stab at.
So this is a huge...
Girls and Boys was, yeah. I mean, like, you know, it was... terrifying and crazy, but it was also really liberating to just, you know, take it off the list in a way and know that it's doable, you know.
And did you ever feel like you really had it while you were doing it, or
had what?
That it was right, that it was perfect, that it was
not perfect. I don't think theatre can ever be perfect, otherwise like you may as well just do the first night and go home. But no, I felt totally I felt like I was telling that story properly. Yeah.
And do you feel that way when you're working most of the time?
Not all the time, no.
What's the scariest thing you work with besides that?
Scariest thing?
Scariest role.
I don't know if there's been a sort of scary... I mean, you know, Shane was pretty scary, but that was because it was a certain point in my career where I probably wasn't ready to back myself in the same way that I am now. And it was just an intimidating talent. You know, Steve McQueen and Michael Fassbender and, like, just going in there with that role. But I don't know. I mean, Girls and Boys are probably... You know, theatre's always going to be, I think, it's scariest. I'm not scared of... I mean, I think, you know, I don't want to do a role on screen unless it's challenging. So I think, you know, I definitely need... There needs to be a sort of healthy amount of fear, but not scary.
So you've mentioned Michael and Steve. Is it playing with them and trying to keep up to that level?
Yeah.
That's scarier than that role, which is a very... Most actresses would consider a pretty dangerous role in many ways.
Yeah, I didn't find the role... I mean, I kind of understood what she was... I kind of figured out what she was going through. So that didn't... It wasn't scary. It was just exciting. Like, you know, to get to go toe-to-toe with Michael and, like... You know, Steve's this extraordinary, like, kind of genius, and he, you know, has this energy, and the pace of the way that he works is so amazing. So, yeah, it wasn't like coming in like, oh, these people, but I had a huge respect for them, and I didn't want to be the weak link in that. I wanted to, you know, to be able to give Michael as much as he was giving me, and, you know, and for Steve as well.
So you got in raves, to say the least, for this role.
Mm.
Does that turn your head? Do you even read them? Do you know that they...
I've been sent, like, two excerpts from two of them, but I haven't... I'll go looking for the bad ones.
Would you normally read them at all, or...?
Maybe, like, down the line, one or two, but not... no.
Did you read your notices on Girls and Mulligan?
No. I was religious about that because I was on my own. And if I'd read a bad review and they'd single things out about my performance, you know, and often they do, they can be really specific about, you know, gestures or behaviors or anything, I would have been completely. So I had to be, I had to like do a complete blackout for that. And no one could send me anything, or I didn't even want to see what was written on the posters because I just, you know, it was too exposing to be on the stage on your own and then see what people sort of aren't.
Any peak sense or uninterested guesser?
And a couple, yeah. I got, you know, people, you gotta read this one. I was like, all right, yeah, I'm human.
Have you had a review that's actually, you think, made you better?
No. Ever? No.
But made you uncomfortable, yeah. Self-aware, which is never good.
Yeah, no, I've never read one and been like, that's interesting, I'll take that note. I've always just been like, oh my god, they hate me. You know, so it's proved itself time and time again to be a terrible idea.
See, I don't think most people believe that you actually have that moment.
What?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I can remember line, like word for word review, a review from The Seagull when I was 22, you know, 21. So yeah, it's just not helpful. And it's one person's opinion, and you know, even if you read a great one, that's one person's opinion.
Yeah. You know. And if you read, if you believe one, you have to believe the other. That's the old,
exactly.
The old adage.
And I don't want to believe the bad one, so I just want to read another one.
Which is weird, because I always kind of, every once in a while, I've heard of somebody who feels like, you know, they did get a note from somewhere that they felt actually was a positive.
I mean, I'm sure there are, you know.
But it's rare.
It's rare, I think. And I'm sure there are, but I don't know if. I, you know, in the same way that I don't watch films that I'm into and think, like, this is how I can critique, I can learn. I, you know, in broad strokes, I come away from a job going, like, okay, I think I can see where I'm weak there and where I need to. But I don't go, like, I'm not into the detail of, like, how to. It feels more like the experience is a learning thing than the product.
I turned on Blue the other night.
You what?
I turned on Inside Louis Davis the other night.
Oh, did you?
And I didn't have to watch the whole thing.
Film.
You're a great joy to watch in that movie.
Thanks, that's nice.
Because I like hearing you curse, it makes me happy.
Well, me too, I'd like to do it more.
There should be more cursing. There's not enough, it's funny, we're talking a conversation today about how kind of passion has been kind of sucked out of mainstream movies.
Well, because we can't swear.
It's not because you can't swear, because they swear more than ever. I think they use the word shit now in PG-13 movies, like, left and right.
Wow.
They use the F word once. They're allowed to say fuck once.
What, in a PG-13?
In a PG-13.
Wow.
But you can't use it more than once, it's an R.
Wow, I didn't know.
Yeah. Just like the rule is, if you're an R, you can have a male penis, but it can't be erect or touched. If that's either one of those things happens, it's an X. From 1917 now.
Fair play.
They're very specific rules about it.
I think that's something to be clear about.
Yeah. But it's weird, like, I think all sexuality has been kind of sucked out of a mainstream cinema now.
Do you think?
Yeah, I think that actresses I think most actresses are afraid of it, because it's so, because of all the weirdness around it, I think. I think there's, like, a culture of the internet and judgment and all that stuff that happens. I think you find people being, a lot, actors being a lot more careful about.
I don't know. I think if you've got, if you're working with a trusted person, there's like a clear artistic endeavor, and anything much has changed. I think probably people are just being more deliberate about choices where there is unnecessary sexual content. Like, you know, people are probably being more circumspect about, you know, totally unnecessary sex scenes. But, you know, I think, you know, there are countless scripts where you read it and think, like, there's no need to see her take her top off. Like, you get that they've had sex. You know, that kind of stuff is probably being scrutinized to a level where it wasn't pre this, because everyone's being a little bit more aware of what they can say no to.
And are you feeling very political about all this stuff these days, or are you kind of...
I mean, I don't think political. I think, you know, I think it's empowering for everyone to know, to have a sort of better view of the field, that we can be clearer and, professional boundaries are respected and all the stuff that kind of should have always been the case, but hasn't been. So I don't feel political, but I feel empowered, and I feel also so grateful for people who have been political and have, you know, made big stances and been really vocal about it, because I think it's all important. Change that, and it's also to prevent it from being a flash in the pan. It does require kind of constant conversation and people pushing it on. And I think people are doing that.
Yeah.
I hope there'll be more of it. My great concern is that the studios are not actually being aggressive enough about kind of setting future boundaries.
Well, and it doesn't need to, it's not that complicated. You know, the first place I worked after I did, after this all happened, was the Royal Court Theatre. Becky Featherston, the artistic director, literally drew up a code of conduct straight afterwards. And when you, first thing I did in rehearsal day one was read it and sign it. That's one big, tiny thing that every production could do that would change the workplace for the people. You know, reading that and then stepping outside of that is really, would be nuts, you know, because it's so clear.
I was thinking just make them sign the golden rule.
The what?
The golden rule, doing others as you're having to do it to you.
Yeah.
And all this would be
but
gone
you know
away.
How people would have done unto themselves, that's the thing. You know, it's got to be, it's a workplace, you know, it shouldn't be that complicated, and it should be, how long does it take for everyone to sit down and read a 3-page document, sign it at the bottom, and, you know, and agree to not break the law at work, you know.
So people know when they're being kind and when they're being jerks.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I don't think anybody's surprised by where the line is. They just want to pretend they don't know.
Exactly, and you need to make it so that they can't pretend they didn't know.
Oh, I'm going to get you off my porch. It's a lovely porch. You're welcome to stay as long as you want, usually.